the exam of civil services, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So in this video we will be talking about our series in which what we do, we daily discuss some questions from prelims perspective. So the name of this series is Let's Solve Some Questions for Prelims 2020. So as the name suggests, this series is not just about solving the questions, but it is also about your participation. So we do expect that if you have any additional information apart from the explanations that are given by us to our questions, then you are more than welcome to comment in the comment box, and we will certainly also take your feedback positively. And there was one feedback, not one feedback, quite I was getting this feedback from quite few days that that the quality of the sound is not good, and also there must be kind of, we can say, use of pen for the explanation. So for this purpose I have ordered both of those things, and most probably they will be delivered tomorrow, and we will be having that both of those instruments to have a better video quality as well as better discussion. So let's start our discussion, friends. Today is video number 21, and today we will be going to discuss the questions from the geography portion of your syllabus. So the first question is quite easy: how does ozone protect us from the harmful ultraviolet radiation? So you might have been reading this topic from class 5th or 6th. So I do expect that you must be knowing its answer. Options are by reflecting the UV radiation back to space, B, by absorbing the ultraviolet radiation and breaking down into oxygen, C, by converting the harmful UV radiation into useful U radiation, D, by changing the frequency of UV radiation coming to Earth. So friends, the question is quite easy, and the answer is B, that is by absorbing UV radiation, that is ultraviolet radiation, and breaking down into oxygen. So ozone layer acts as a filter for shorter wavelength and highly hazardous this ultraviolet radiation. So you might also be asked about the wavelength of the ultraviolet radiation, because it is quite important. So you must be you should be aware of this fact that it is basically of shorter wavelength, and it and the ozone layer protects Earth from this potentially harmful ultraviolet radiation. It absorbs UV radiation and breaks down the radiation into oxygen. So oxygen is different from ozone. So there is an inverse relationship between stratospheric ozone and the solar UV arc measured at Earth's surface. That is, lower the ozone levels, the higher the solar UV arc. So the formation of ozone holes severely affect ozone's ability to filter UV rays. Now let's move on to the next question. Next is, all changes in weather are ultimately caused by the A, hydrological cycle on Earth, B, primordial heat inside the Earth, C, rotation of Earth, D, energy of the Sun. So we have to choose the correct answer. So you might be quite surprised to know its answer, because most of the students would have said that okay, rotation of Earth is responsible for the changing weather conditions. But then ultimately it is the energy of the Sun, that is D, that is that causes weather changes. So at some places there is larger solar insolation, and some places some places on Earth are quite we can say cool. So that's why this Sun plays an important role in weather by ensuring the wind circulation that is there. So to certain extent, rotation of Earth is also responsible, but the more plausible answer is here, the D. So Earth's hydrological cycle is only partly responsible for the weather. So obviously hydrological cycle doesn't play much role, but then this would also be quite wrong to say, because latest research is showing that hydrological cycle is playing a great role in contributing towards the carbon emissions. So that is a thing that is quite debatable, but as of now you take this that Earth's hydrological cycle is not that much responsible. So rainfall pattern movements of ocean water. So obviously A is incorrect. So primordial heat inside the Earth manifests itself in the form of moving molten magma inside the Earth. So it is responsible basically for the tectonic activity that takes place, and it is not responsible for weather phenomena. So B option is clear. clearly wrong, and also C is also incorrect, because rotation of earth does cause wind movements, that and the change of the day and the night and the distribution of heat on earth. However, it does not explain several other phenomena. For example, if there is extreme heat and on equators, and then cold in poles extra, so all these reasons are basically due to all this extreme variation in the climatic condition is basically due to the different amount of solar energy received by different parts of earth differently. So the sun's energy causes all these and is ultimately and basically and fundamentally responsible for life and activity on earth, which also subsumes weather phenomena. So sun is the primary source of energy. You might be aware of that fact, because all the changes in the weather or all the life activity is based upon the sun's energy. Because if photosynthesis take place, then only the energy is converted into chemical form material form. So in that case, obviously then energy is derived from sun. So it is the basic source of energy. So heat from sun causes changes in temperature, pressure, evaporation, biological activity. So all these in turn determine the weather at a place. Now let's move on to the next question. Next is, which of the following will increase the strength of a cyclone? A, proximity to land surfaces. B, heat released from condensation of water vapor. C, absence of cloud formation. D, lowering temperature of sea water. So here we have to choose that which of these could be responsible for increasing the strength of the cyclone. So you might be aware of the fact, if you have read this cyclone topic from NCERTs, or if you might have covered it from other sources, then the heat released during the condensation is basically responsible. It increases the strength of the cyclone, because ultimately the heat released causes the increase in the overall temperature of the cyclone system. So which and ultimately heat is what is basically responsible for the cyclone. So it increases its strength when heat is released from condensation of water vapor. So land surfaces break cyclone as supply of moisture is cut off. So option A is wrong. So absence of clouds reduces the strength of a cyclone. The process of formation of clouds involves evaporation of water and then rainfall. So if there are no clouds, then the strength of a cyclone will be reduced. As explained below, rainfall will involve condensation, which will enhance the strength of a cyclone, because obviously moisture is needed to the cyclone. And then lowering temperature of sea water will reduce formation of water vapor and increase the pressure of the eye of the cyclone, and this will reduce the strength instead of increasing it. So before cloud formation, water takes up heat from the atmosphere to change into vapor. So when water vapor changes back to liquid form as raindrops, so this heat is released in the atmosphere. So the heat released to the atmosphere warms the air around, and air tends to rise and causes a drop in pressure, and then more air rushes to the center of the storm. This cycle is repeated. So this results the chain of events ultimately led to the formation of a very low pressure system with high pressure vents revolving around it, and this is what a cyclone phenomena is. That is a very low pressure system surrounded by a very high speed wind system. Surrounded by an area that has high air pressure. So it is this weather condition that we call a cyclone. So factors like wind speed, wind direction, temperature and humidity contribute to the development of cyclones. Now let's move to the next question. Next is, India does not produce large amounts of gold. Which of these can be possible reasons? First, some gold mines in India are very deep, which makes commercial extraction expensive. Second, India's gold reserves are highly scarce. Third, technological barriers exist and extraction is risky. So friends, you might be aware of this fact that certainly there are technological barriers regarding the extraction of gold, but certainly gold reserves are not scarce, because there in South India there are mines, and India has been found quite rich in this this reserve, but the problem with it is that India's gold mines are very deep, and it makes their extraction unviable. So obviously, and also then technological barriers are there, because the cheap technology is not available for the extraction, so which causes huge expensive costs and render the gold uncompetitive? So the answer is C, that is 1 and 3 only. So India currently produces hardly 0.4% of its gold consumption despite having 9% of global gold reserves. So that is not bad, quite bad. That is good. So under the country's landmass, so statement 2 is clearly wrong. And though the private entrepreneurs have come forward for reconnaissance, hardly less than 1% of them have come up to mining stage. So this is mainly for want of latest technology, high risk capital, extra. So government is also formulating a new mining policy to boost exploration of gold and diamond deposits and cut down the country's over dependence on import. So Kolar in Karnataka has deposits of gold. So you must be aware of this region, Kolar in Karnataka. Kolar mines is quite famous. So these mines are among the deepest in the world, which makes mining of this ore a very expensive process. So statement is correct. Statement 1 is correct. Now let's move on to the last question of the day. Last question is, which of the following can be done using Earth observation satellites? First, crop production forecast. Second, snow and glacier studies. Third, ocean primary productivity. Fourth, landslide hazard zonation. And then site selection for hydropower. So we have to choose the correct answer. So let me tell you, friends, that all of these things can be done using Earth observation satellite. So if, for example, there is Earth observation satellite, then it will analyze the area under a particular crop, and then crop production forecast can take place. And then snow and glacier studies can be done, that how the glaciers are melting or snow is melting, so what were the patterns earlier. And also then ocean primary productivity could be analyzed by satellite imagery. And then landslide hazard zonation can be done, and site selection for hydropower can also be done. So answer is D, all of the above. So remote sensing satellites take imagery of the earth. So green area is generally considered as either forest or plantation. So it is possible to forecast crop production. Statement 1 is correct. So if the image is white, it may be interpreted as ice. So hence statement 2 is also correct. So if patches of green are seen amidst huge bodies of water, that signals presence of phytoplankton. So presence of primary productivity of ocean. So you might be aware of this phytoplankton. So using imagery for information, it is possible to remotely assess an area for landslides or finding if it's suitable for generating hydropower. So statements 4 and 5 are also correct. So these were the 5 questions of today. So if you have scored 5 out of 5, then it is quite good. But if you have scored 1, 2, 3, 4 or 0, then it is very, very, very good. In fact, that student who has scored 0, I would appreciate that this thing is very good, because at least you have seen the video. At least you have learned something. You have gained something which you are not aware about. So this is not that this is a wastage of time. So you see that we are scoring very less. See, what will ultimately matter is that how you will perform in the real time examination. So calculating marks here doesn't really matter. So what matters is the gradual process, gradual movement in the forward direction towards completion of your syllabus. So I expect that if few people follow these videos regularly, then you certainly be in a better condition 5 or 6 months down the line. So also then other thing is that scores are not to be counted at the very first instance. First you have to take questions as sources of learning. So if you are reading, then you are just reading. But when you are solving questions, then you are becoming aware of the pattern of the UPSC, how the UPSC asks questions, and also you are becoming aware about how to prepare for UPSC. So this immensely helps you in cracking the examination. So I do request you to don't count your scores and measure your performance on the yardstick of the number of questions that you have solved. Measure your progress by the yardstick that at least you have learned something today. So this is all about today's video, and friends, we have various series in which we are covering different books for the purpose of CSE preparation. So there is one book that is The Brief History of Modern India by Rajiv Ahir, and there is one book that is Indian Polity by M. Lakshmikant, and then also there is Indian Economy by Ramesh Singh, and also then Geography book is there of G.C. Leong. So we have, friends, on our platform launched multiple series to cover those topics. So in them, what we do, we give you a time bound timetable. So we strictly follow that, and you are given a daily target on according to which you are asked to prepare. And in the evening, we take your test by giving you the questions. So this ensures the timely completion of your syllabus in a time bound manner and in a proper framework, so that you can feel confident ultimately when you complete your syllabus. So in case you are interested, then you can join these series. So we also have not just standard book series, but we also have NCERT series. For example, we have Geography NCERT series, History NCERT series, Art and Culture series, and then Indian Polity series also, and then Indian Polity by M. Lakshmikant. That book, the MCQs based on this book are also constitute also one of the series that we have. So if in case you are interested, then obviously you have to check the description box. So all the details are mentioned there. So how it will benefit you? So you might be aware of the fact that the NCERTs and these standard books are the foundations of your preparation. So coverage of entire syllabus will be through MCQ mode, and this will ensure discipline in your studies, because most of the students today prepare from home and they are not in metropolitan cities, but they face the problem of regularity in studies or discipline in studies. So this approach will ensure that there is a necessary discipline in your studies, and you complete your syllabus in a time bound manner, and then also problem of revising multiple sources will also be solved, because we will be giving you questions by covering diverse sources, and you will also be getting these MCQs with their explanations. So all important topics regarding that are in these books, so they will be covered through MCQs. So you need not revise the standard books again and again. You can revise them 2-3 times, but when it comes to your exam near you, then obviously it is not advisable to read a 500 page book. So in that case, such type of explanations will help you the most, and also these books are widely recommended by various toppers. It is not that just we are promoting these books. So, and then also mere reading is not enough, because you must know how the UPSC frames questions. So how the questions are framed and how we should prepare for the UPSC. So idea only comes when you solve these MCQs. So discipline preparation, again I say that it gives you much needed self confidence. And also, when your prelims is just 6 months away, then obviously now is the best time to start, because if you are waiting for anything, I don't know if in case you are waiting for anything, but that thing is. But do ensure that you join the series as soon as possible for the purpose of preparation for prelims 2020. So if in case you have any doubts, queries, you can check the description box. So the link of all these series that we have for the purpose of CSE preparation is given in the description box. So you can check the description box, and also then in the description box we have given the link of our Telegram channel, that is the link of which is shown on your screen. And on this Telegram channel we have more than 15,000 students that follow us, and they have access to various public resources that we share for the purpose of CSE preparation. For example, the PDFs of these discussions are also available on this Telegram channel. So in case you want to access those public resources, then you're more than welcome to check the description box and join our Telegram channel using this link. So friends, this is all about today's video. If you have any doubts, queries, then you can ask in the comment box, and also you can contact us directly through the mail that is given in the description box, and also through the contact number that is also mentioned there. So this is all about, friends, today's video. Do ensure that you like it, share it with your friends, and also ensure that you subscribe to our channel. So thank you, friends.